السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله وكفى وسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى، لا سيما المصطفى صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. We'll praise thee to Allah alone, we'll praise him and we'll seek his help. Whomsoever Allah guides is a truly guided one, and whomsoever Allah leaves astray, no one can show him guidance. May the best peace and blessings be upon Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. Dear viewers everywhere, welcome to a new edition of Ask Huda. Our contact information is beginning with the phone numbers, area code 002-0238-555-248-249. The email address is ask@huda.tv. The Facebook page is www.facebook.com/msalahofficial. And without any further ado, I would like to tackle a couple of pending questions by the time you start ringing in. The first one we have is pertaining Hajj from a money that was borrowed from an Islamic bank. The question deals with a couple of things. Number one, borrowing. Number two, performing Hajj from a loan that the person borrows and whether it's permissible or not. So borrowing money is permissible whenever the person is in need. Whenever the person is in need. And it should be without interest. Should be qardun hasan, without interest. These are the two conditions. A person who borrows just simply to keep some money in his account, this is what I understood from the question earlier, is not permissible. If you are in business and you'd like to expand and it is needed to borrow a qardun hasan, or to have somebody enter with you in the business as a partner, to have a partnership where you guys both share the profit and the loss, that is permissible. You believe that you want to move to a bigger house and you need just certain amount of money and it is definitely needed to move to the other house or to buy a house since you're living in a rental property and you know that it is affordable, you can certainly settle the debt, that too is permissible. But to borrow money to keep it with you because they offer you, if you're working in this business or in this job, to give you a loan and you take it and you just keep it with you, there's no need for it. Number two, with regards to Hajj, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَلِلَّهِ عَلَى النَّاسِ حِجُّ الْبَيْتِ مَنِ اسْتَطَاعَ إِلَيْهِ سَبِيلًا. This is out of mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Said Hajj is mandatory upon mankind, the believers of course, amongst them, with one condition, which is الاستطاعة. الاستطاعة consists of financial capability and physical ability. So if the person physically able to travel and to perform Hajj and is healthy, but he doesn't have the means, then it is not due upon him to perform Hajj. It is not mandatory. The pillars of Islam will be shahadati an la ilaha illallah, performing salah, fasting during Ramadan if he can, and if he still has some money which is zakatable, to pay zakah. But if he cannot afford to perform Hajj, he is not blameworthy. Well, what about borrowing in order to perform Hajj? It is not required, but is it permissible? Yes, it is permissible when you know that it's in your hands reach, without interest, and you can afford to pay the loan. Like somebody has a steady job or a business and he knows that his annual income is that much. And if you were to borrow a few thousand in order to complete the fund that he's been saving to go for Hajj, he just needs a few more thousands, which once he returns, it will be easy and accessible for him to settle his debt. Then that is fine, and his Hajj will be accepted, and the person who will give him the goodly loan will be rewarded as well. But it is not required to borrow money, even if it is an interest not interest-based, halal qard hasan, in order to perform Hajj or Umrah. Sabr from United Arab Emirates asked a question in a previous episode pertaining the surah, which if the person recites will protect him against poverty and will increase his wealth. Yeah, we all know this surah since I was a child. We memorize this surah because the common athar or a statement which we use to think it's a hadith, but it is not a hadith. There are many fabricated statements pertaining the verses of the Quran. You know, some people fabricated verses for each surah of the Quran, like Nuh ibn Abi Maryam. His intent was good, but that was an evil practice. Because the Prophet ﷺ said that whoever attributes to me a statement which I did not say, then let him expect his seat in the far off hell. The hadith says, من كذب علي متعمدا فليتبوأ مقعده من النار. There are many means to acquire wealth and increase your provision, such as supplications to be recited in the morning and in the evening, constantly making istighfar, very oftenly sending the peace and the blessings upon the Prophet ﷺ, giving in charity, and frequently asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless you and increase your provision. And on top of these things is upholding the ties of your kinship. مَنْ أَحَبَّ أَنْ يُبْسَطَ لَهُ فِي أَثَرِهِ أَنْ يُنْسَأَ لَهُ فِي أَثَرِهِ وَيُبْسَطَ لَهُ فِي رِزْقِهِ فَلْيَصِلُ رَحِمَهُ. In this sound hadith, the Prophet ﷺ says, whosoever likes his provision to increase, to get wealthy, to have barakah in his wealth, in his positions, and would like to have a long life, a long in a sense that is not like he was supposed to live for 60, it will be doubled to be 120 or 80 or more or less, but rather it means the barakah. So the one day will be worth a year or two. This is the meaning of al-baslu fi al-rizq wa al-nasa'u fi al-umr. Increase in one's lifespan, give him a barakah or a blessings in the time that he lives in this dunya. Let him uphold the ties of his kinship. Visit your uncle, your aunt, take care of your parents, give gifts to your nephews and nieces, visit family members, whether they are close or far away, distant relatives. These are amongst the best means of increasing your provision. The surah, which the athar, which was fabricated in this regard, is Surah Al-Waqi'ah. But it is not proven to be a hadith. So that's why we do not recite it before going to sleep, believing that if you recite it, it will protect you against poverty, because there is no reference to that. Okay? But it is recommended to recite Surah Tabarak Al-Mulk, of course, in the evening and prior to going to sleep. Manar from Egypt. She says, is it okay to greet someone or congratulate someone on their birthday by saying happy birthday? The congratulation is a celebration. When you say to somebody who's celebrating any occasion, halal or haram, happy occasion to this occasion, happy Christmas to you. We ask, what kind of Christmas you mean? What is the meaning of Christmas? Christmas Eve, Halloween, we ask. So based on the occasion, the congratulation or the greeting will be judged, whether it's halal or haram. And we all know that neither the Prophet ﷺ nor any of his companions or our rightly guided khulafa or scholars have ever crossed their minds to celebrate their birthdays. These are all traditions of other religions. لَكُمْ دِينُكُمْ وَلِيَ دِينُ. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said. Let them celebrate their occasions, their celebrations, and we too have our own celebrations, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the hadith. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Nashwa from Egypt, welcome to Ask Huda. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Doctor, I have two questions.
Naam.
First, Dr. Muhammad, I am graduated from Faculty of Arts English Department 4-3 years ago.
Naam.
And I hope to make use of my studying English language to serve Islam and serve Da'wah. But I don't know the steps that I can follow to achieve that. Is there any books or any Islamic books in English language that I can read or to develop my English Islamic concepts and vocabularies? Or is there any courses that I can hold?
Yes, of course. Okay. I would just like to correct one thing. I hope you said to serve, not save, because neither you nor me or anyone would save Islam or the religion. I may misheard it, but it's rather serve.
Okay, I
said serve. Okay. Jazakallahu khairan. Barakallahu fik. It's an honor for every believer to serve this deen. I will answer your question, inshallah, after I take the following phone calls. Assalamu alaikum. Wasim from the KSA.
Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh.
Salaam alaikum, Asim. How are you?
Alhamdulillah. How are you, Sheikh?
I'm fine. Barakallah feek.
Sheikh, I have one question, Sheikh.
Yeah.
When you are performing the congregation prayers in Isha, Imam forget to go to do two, instead of two sujood, he did only one sujood in the last rakah. Do we have to repeat the whole prayer or we have to pray only one rakah and finish it up?
Tell me first, what did the Imam do? Because the prayer is already done. I want to know what did the Imam do.
He finished, after the prayer, when he finished the only one sujood, then he sit in At-Tahiyyat. Then he finished the At-Tahiyyat and he finished the Salam and he get up. He sat on this one. And afterwards, he prayed afterwards four rakahs completely. We repeated the prayer.
Four rakahs. Okay. Yeah. Any of the followers, did any of the Ma'mumin notice that the Imam was missing one sajda? Did they alert him by saying, Subhanallah?
Nobody alerted him.
Wow. Subhanallah. Everybody was daydreaming. Okay. I'll answer you, Asim, inshallah. Barakallah feek. Abu Muhammad from United Arab Emirates. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. How are you, Sheikh?
Alhamdulillah, shukla. Barakallah feek, Abu Muhammad.
I love you for the sake of Allah.
أحبك الذي أحببتني فيه. May Allah, the one whom you love me for his sake, love you too. Barakallah feek. I love to hear that. And you know, inshallah, that will be our path to paradise, you and I. Inshallah, Azza wa Jal.
Ameen. Okay, brother, I have one question.
Yeah.
My parents owned a house, which my brother and I contributed to a substantial amount through our business. The property was in the UK. We moved city within UK. So my parents sold the existing property, and we purchased another one in a different city. The transaction was done sort of secretly. After, when we bought the new property, the extra paid was from the company that me and my brother actually owned. If I can I give you a figure? Then you probably have some figures.
That's fine,
mind.
No problem.
Okay, the sale price was 500,000, and the new property that we purchased was for 650.
Okay.
Now, the original property was in my parents' name, 50-50. Now my father gave his share to my brother. 50% of the new property. Today, the property is only worth about 1.3.
MashaAllah.
Now, is this gift considered fair in Islam? And if not, what would be the correct way to rectify it?
Are you talking about... Okay, I'm sorry, I missed one thing. Are you talking about dividing the shares? Or what do you mean exactly?
Yeah, because the gift of 50% share that my father gave just to my brother, just one person.
Okay.
So now that property is in my mother's name and my brother's name.
Okay. Barakallahu feek. I hope inshallah. But this question, hopefully inshallah, I will answer after this segment. Inshallah Azza wa Jalla. Hang around. Umar Abdurrahman from the KSA. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum
assalam
wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I want to ask if there's any hadith related on what Aisha radiallahu anha looked like during her lifetime, what her appearance was, what kind of clothes she wore. I was just wondering if anything related about her
okay.
and her appearance. Jazakallah khair.
Wa jazakum barakallah fi. Sister Nashwa from Egypt, who studied English, and she wants to utilize her education to serve the deen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you. When you have this concern, that's a blessing. There are a lot of people who have the means and they do not realize that they were created to serve this purpose, which they were created for. So with regards to English books pertaining Islam and Dawah, there are many. And since you are in Egypt, there's a very famous publisher, Dar es Salaam of Riyadh. I really vouch for their translations to the Arabic books, especially the beautiful collection of the abridged tafsir of Ibn Kathir. And it is available in a soft copy, and it's available for free as well online if you want to download it. Amazing, amazing effort. May Allah bless these guys and every person who spent much time and effort in order to put this work together. The sea and nectar of Ar-Rahiq Al-Makhtoum, Safi Ar-Rahman Al-Mubarakafuri, may Allah bless him, Riyadu Al-Saliheen, Gardens of the Pious, many books which if you read in English will be very easy to comprehend the meaning since you already know most of these informations in Arabic, okay? And they have a branch in Cairo downtown by Al-Azhar Mosque. So this is one thing. Second, if you're talking about the means of giving da'wah, there are many courses. There is the University of Dr. Bilal Phillips, may Allah preserve him. There is Mishkaya University, which we announced that it offers courses, distant learning and online courses. It's located in the United States. I have the honor of teaching in this university and in others as well, because you can study in it at your convenience, at the convenience of your home. You don't have to travel, you don't have to go here and there, and you can communicate with the tutors during the live sessions, like you're sitting in the class, but it's virtual classes. There is Huda Academy, of course, and there are courses on Aqeedah and Tafsir and Hadith, etc. Go check them out online. And also, these organizations, whether Mishkad, Islamic University of North America, Huda Academy, or Islamic University of Dr. Bilal Phillips, I do believe they offer scholarship or they can give break for those who cannot afford to pay. I also understand that the payment is, it is not to create a profit, rather to support other projects. Yani when you have to pay for a course with Huda Academy, for instance, all the tutors are not being paid. It's all for the sake of Allah, alhamdulillah, shukrullah, hopefully Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will accept. But this is to support other programs of Huda Academy. Similarly, other organizations. So if there is a chance to get a break or to get a scholarship, they will be more than happy to provide you with that. But communication is very important. You have to, as you studied English, you know that the conversation in English is the key. It's not sufficient to read. It's very important to have a tutor, to have a sheikh in this regard. You would hear from him. You would know the different methods of giving da'wah. There is a whole curriculum that we teach at Mishkaya University called the methodology of da'wah. So alhamdulillah wa shukrullah, this is for everybody, not only for the questioner. Allah has made it easy for any person and every person who is undergraduate or postgraduate, have a PhD degree or whatever, to continue their education at the convenience of their homes and attend the classes whenever. Download the videos, listen to the lectures, read the textbook, take the exams, make some effort. The Prophet ﷺ said, إِنَّمَا الْعِلْمُ بِالتَّعَلُّمُ. In order to be a scholar or a learned person, you have to seek knowledge. I have some of my students revert. And alhamdulillah, shukla, I have to acknowledge the fact that the girls are much more active and they have this high zeal more than the boys. In less than a year or two, they did not only finish the tajweed and they know how to read the Quran properly, they memorized several paras. And they're very keen to get an ijazah as well. While many people who were born in Islam and their native language is Arabic, still do not know how to read Surah Al-Fatiha. Unfortunately, in one sitting in Tajweed Halqa, one person who is a professor, an Arabic, an Egyptian, was sitting in the Halqa, and when he came to read Surah Al-Baqarah, it was his turn, he said, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Alam. Never heard Alif Lam Mim. Why? Because he did not seek this knowledge. He was not exposed to reading the Quran before. So, إِنَّمَا الْعِلْمُ بِالتَّعَلُّمُ. And I will pray for you. May Allah make it easy for you and for every person who is so sincere and keen to seek the religious knowledge. And that is the greatest. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَنْ سَلَكَ طَرِيقًا يَبْتَغِي بِهِ عِلْمًا سَهَّلَ اللَّهُ لَهُ بِهِ طَرِيقًا إِلَى الْجَنَّةِ. This is your easy path to paradise. You seek a path in order to learn, seek the religious knowledge. Allah will facilitate a way for you to paradise. May Allah make us amongst them. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Sister Asia from the KSA. Assalamu alaikum. Okay, we apologize for that. Try again, please, Sister Asia. That call was cut off. Brother Wasim from the KSA. This is something which I mentioned repeatedly. 10 minutes of your time, you will learn what to do in case of forgetfulness in the prayer. Whether you miss a part or you pray extra, by minus or by adding to the prayer. Sujood al-Sahw, very simple. You don't have to get master's degree on Sujood al-Sahw. By the way, some people do so, but specialists. You just need to know what to do. Imagine an imam and a ma'mumun, everybody, because he missed a sajda, they just repeated the whole prayer over. Is this the right thing to do? No, of course not. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it easy. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had forgotten in his prayer a couple times. Once he prayed the four rak'ah prayers, it was dhuhr, he prayed them only two. And once he prayed the four rak'ah prayers, he prayed them five. So once by minus, once by adding. And I believe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it this way so that the ummah will recognize that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was a human being, subject to things which happen to ordinary human beings. Number two, he made him forget so that he would teach us how to rectify any errors happen in the prayer due to forgetfulness. Just pray two sajdas. But if what you forgot is a wajib or is a fard, then you need to make it up. Then add the two sajdas by the end, which are known as sajdatay sahw, the two prostrations of making up for forgetfulness. In this case, the imam forgot one sajda, and he made it so easy for us. He said it was in the last rak'ah. So even if he made the tashahud and he finished, and somebody told him, "Ya Sheikh, you only prayed one sajda," we're supposed to, whenever we realize that the imam have forgotten or is getting ready to pray extra, to say Subhanallah. And the women would clap in order to alert the imam. But what's really sad that everybody was daydreaming. Nobody realized. As a friend of mine, one of the doctors was telling me that the imam once was praying Asr and he prayed three rak'ahs and nobody realized. Only one person kept saying Subhanallah. After the prayer is finished, he said, "You only prayed three rak'ahs." The imam insisted, "No, I prayed four." He said, "No, you prayed three." He said, "How come that you're the only person who realized? No one figured this out, which means you're mistaken." He said, "No, because I have four stores, and in every rak'ah, I audit, you know, one store. So I basically got to do three. There is one store missing. That means there is one rak'ah missing." It's not funny though, because even the person who was attentive because of dunya. What I'm trying to say is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Mu'minun, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. Successful indeed are the believers. And their very first quality is, الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ. Those who tranquil and pay attention in their prayer, they gain khushu' in their prayer. I will answer you inshallah after this phone call, how to do to rectify this error in the prayer without having to repeat the whole rak'ahs again. Assalamu alaikum. Brother Khushid, welcome to the program. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah wa barakatuh. How are you, Sheikh?
I'm fine, alhamdulillah wa shukrillah.
Sheikh, I'm having two questions on 10th of Muharram.
No.
First of all, I received a call from India, one of my very close friends, and he said that, Khurshid, my parents have made a huge amount of food on 10th of Muharram to distribute to the poor.
Mm.
And I didn't eat that. I told them that if you want to distribute on 9th, 10th, 11th, 12th, no problem. But I didn't eat. So did I make a mistake or did I do the correct thing? Can you ask Sheikh Salah this?
Naam. Okay.
Number two. Sheikh, just correct me if I'm wrong. In one of your episodes, you tell us that this 10th of Muharram was before the birth of our Prophet, Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Yes, indeed.
So can you just give a brief discussion on this, sir, that what is the reason, why on 10th? What is the meaning of 10th? Because in Asian countries, since last 100 years, I can say, because I am, mashallah, 50, that people mashallah are thinking only because of Hussein and Hassan.
Yeah, mashallah.
May Allah peace upon him, on them. And because of that, this is the 10th of Muharram is there. So why, what was the thing, why, what is the importance of 10th of Muharram in Islam?
حاضر. بارك الله فيك.
Thank
brother
you very much.
جزاك الله خيرا. Thank you so much. بارك الله فيك. Okay. With regards to what to do when you forget the last sajda, then you make tashahud and you make taslim. In this case, if nobody reminded you, and after the prayer somebody told you that you only made one sujood, and you guys were in dispute or in doubt, then simply go for sujood to make this missing sajda. Then sit down to make the two prostrations of as-sahw. Okay? So this one sajda will be the rukn. The prayer consists of pillars, wajibat, and sunan. With regards to the pillars, if you miss any of these pillars, the prayer, the whole prayer is invalid. Pillars such as the beginning takbir, standing in the prayer, reciting Surah Al-Fatiha, making ruku', making sujood, and so on. Wajib, such as reciting the tashahud, and sunan, such as the middle, the sitting for the middle tashahud. That sitting, if the person missed, simply he can just make the two sujood afterward, and he does not have to make up the middle tashahud, because it's a sunnah. But the sujood is a rukn, is a pillar, so the person is required to do it. And if the person forgot this sujood in any rak'ah other than the last rak'ah, then he has this allowance to still return back to the prostration position and make up the sajda, as long as he does not reach to the same position of the following rak'ah. I hope you get this. I'm in the first rak'ah. I forgot the sajda of the first rak'ah. I made one sajda, then I got up. While I was reciting Surah Al-Fatiha, or while I was making ruku', or after rising up from ruku', I remembered that I only made one sajda. So in this case, I return back to the sujood position. I make this one sajda, then resume. Go to the second rak'ah and continue. Okay? But if I did not remember until I made sujood of the second rak'ah, then the first rak'ah, the whole rak'ah is void. Because this whole unit is defected, is missing one rukn. So you consider the second rak'ah as the first rak'ah, which means after supposedly you were supposed to finish the prayer at this tashahud, now you pray this extra rak'ah. It is not extra, rather it's to make up for the corrupt rak'ah or the violated rak'ah, the first rak'ah. I hope I didn't confuse you. But if you listen to this again, inshallah, it will be very easy. You just got to have to go for a short break. And inshallah, we'll join you back in a couple of minutes. So please stay tuned. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. And welcome back. I hope my dear beloved viewers got to understand the concept of sujood al-sahw, especially if the person forgets a pillar of one rak'ah, he still have the chance to make it up as long as he does not finish the following rak'ah and come to the same position of the missing pillar. Then afterwards, simply pray two prostrations for the forgetfulness or to make up for whatever you've forgotten. That, if what's missing was a fard, for instance. But if it was a sunnah, there is no need to make up the sunnah. It would be sufficient to pray sujood as-sahw. So, in his case, if any person have reminded him, simply he will make this one sajda. Then, after he would recite the tashahud, pray the two prostrations of forgetfulness, and then make taslim. It's as simple as that. Abu Muhammad from United Arab Emirates, the case that you discussed, I will try, inshallah, to give you my answer in the light of what I understood, that you and your brother invested in a house to buy for your parents. It was worth 500,000, and now when they sold it, it was like 650, and he gave 50% of this money to your brother. So maybe your question is pertaining the distribution of the value of this house Or why did the father give to one brother and did not give the other similar to that, or did not give him entirely? Of course, I hope that your father, inshallah, is a Muslim, to understand that it is not befitting, nor is it permissible for a father to give any of his children a property or a gift that has a value and deprive the others. We have the hadith of An-Nu'man ibn Bashir radiyallahu an, when his father came to give him a gift and asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam to testify to that. It was a property. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam's first question was, do you have other children other than An-Nu'man? He said, yes. He said, did you give each and every one of them similar to what you gave to An-Nu'man? He said, no. He said, then go find somebody else to testify to that, because this is falsehood. وَإِنِّي لَأَشْهَدُ عَلَىٰ زُورٍ. I hope I understood your question. So the advice is, whether the wealth is his or it was initially yours, you and your brother, he shouldn't give one extra than the others, or give one and deprive the others, because this is an unfair treatment and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbade so. Again, if you have any comment on that, or if you'd like to add to the question anything, at the control, they will be more than happy to take it from you, and inshallah azajal, I can comment on that. Brother Khurshid from United Arab Emirates said that in India, he got a call from India that during the day of Ashura, they prepare plenty of food and they give it to the poor. Giving food to the poor on any day is recommended. But the problem is with believing that you should give on a particular day or a particular night. There are some fabricated ahadith in this regard with regards to the virtues of cooking plenty of food, to the extent that not only in India, in Egypt for instance, because it was occupied by the Fatimites. The Fatimites were not Muslims, by the way. The Fatimites who introduced to this ummah all this myth, these celebrations of the Prophet's birthday and death day, and Al-Husayn, Al-Hasan, and Aisha, and Zainab, and all of that. All these occasions were invented by these guys. Okay, it's a sect of Shia, and the Fatimites were not Muslims, to the extent that they considered the leader, Mu'izz al-Din Allah al-Fatimi, as a divine being also. So what I'm trying to say is, these traditions have nothing to do with Islam. You brought up a very interesting thing, which you said that in India, they believe that Ashura have anything to do with the death or the martyrdom of Al-Husayn. May Allah be pleased with him. Of course, every time we say his name, we say radiyallahu anhu. Ahlul Sunnati wal Jama'ah, the mainstream of this ummah, love the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his household and his family members more than anybody else. More than anybody else. And we consider the love, يعني, when we love Ahlul Bayt, this is one of the best means of approach to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to enter his paradise. By loving the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Ahlul Baytah. And the love requires to do what pleases the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and to follow his footsteps, not to innovate. Aisha radiallahu anha, and by the way, these guys don't like Aisha, of course. So whatever I quote from Aisha, they say, we don't believe in her ahadith. We don't believe in Abu Bakr. We don't believe in Umar. But they believe in these occasions. I guess everybody has seen a couple of days ago, as we were Ahlul Sunnah, we were fasting on the day of Ashura, hoping that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will expiate the sins of the past year, as it has been narrated in the hadith, and in many hadith, of course, some other people were celebrating by beating themselves and representing themselves as Muslims. What an awful image and an awful picture that they were showing to the whole world. You know what? God forbid, if I was not a Muslim, and I see these people beating themselves, they injuring themselves, nobody's torturing them, they're torturing themselves. And blood all over, with swords and with chains, with medals and all of them, saying, I'm not interested in this religion. I don't want to hurt myself. I'm trying to spare myself and be safe. Would I enter a religion where people hurt themselves, beat themselves to bleed, and sometimes even kill themselves? A lot of killing incidents. They kill themselves. Why? For no reason. Mere innovation. وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ بِكُمْ رَحِيمًا. The hadith says, and the hadith is a sound hadith, كان أهل الجاهلية, the people in Jahiliyyah before Islam, before Islamic era, they used to fast on the 10th of Muharram. Whether they know for what reason or not, it has been a tradition. This tradition has been since the time of Prophet Moses, peace be upon him. When Allah drowned the Pharaoh and saved Musa and his followers, the 12 tribes of the Israelites, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Musa alayhi salam, wanted to thank Allah, so he fasted on that day. He observed fasting on that day. And it has been a tradition ever since. Similarly, the Meccans used to do certain things, tawaf, sa'i. These are the traditions and the manasik of Ibrahim alayhi salam, but they have altered it a great deal. They used to do tawaf around the Kaaba naked, in the nude. And instead of saying labbaik, they would whistle and clap. They have changed due to innovations. So they used to fast even before the birth of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam arrived to Al-Madinah, and this is a hadith now which is narrated by Abdullah ibn Abbas, Ahlul Bayt, you should respect them and take their hadith. He entered Al-Madinah and he found the Jews were fasting on that day. He said, what is the occasion? Why do we fast on that day? They said, this is the day on which Allah saved Bani Israel. So Musa decided to thank Allah by fasting on that day. So the Prophet ﷺ said, نَحْنُ أَحَقُّ بِمُوسَى مِنْهُمْ. We do have more rights with Musa than them. We follow Musa. Musa is my brother. He belongs to us. We belong to him. These guys do not belong to Musa. So we should fast. And this is when Ashura was considered as a wajib to fast before the mandate of fasting of Ramadan. Of course, after fasting of Ramadan was considered mandatory, every other fasting has become mere mandub, recommended. And the only mandatory fasting is the month of Ramadan. And the Prophet ﷺ kept fasting, and he said the virtues of fasting on the day, that fasting on the 10th of Ashura forgives the sins, the entire sins of the past year, the minor sins, of course. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Brother Abu Muhammad from United Arab Emirates.
Okay, brother. Thank you for the answer. I just wanted to clarify a quick thing. Okay, basically, what is the best way now to rectify this? Obviously, there has been an uplift in value of the property.
You're Abu Muhammad with the property, right?
Yes.
I mean, did I understand your question properly?
Yes, you did.
Okay. To rectify this, I need to speak to your dad, because he's the one who's supposed to rectify this by paying you the balance, exactly the same amount that he paid your brother at the time when he paid the money.
So it should be done as well. This was 8 years ago, so this should be done at the price of the property at that time.
Well, do you still have the property though?
Yes, the property is still here. Yeah, we still have the property. It's not been disposed of.
Okay, this compensation can be sorted out in the light of, look, let's say for instance, that if you guys still have the property and we may consider it some sort of investment, how much was it back then versus how much is it now, then we calculate the profit and it can be adjusted. Bottom line, and what's really important is to keep in mind that even, please, if your father did not so, you gotta forgive him, because he will be in trouble with the divine law if he insisted on not paying you your right. And you wouldn't like your father to be in trouble because of that. But please explain to him that you have to pay me similar to what you paid my brother. We got to keep in mind there are other calculations, such as maybe the brother was in debt, so he's giving him a loan, giving him some help while you are well off, or the brother is handicapped, or the brother is in a distress that you're not experiencing, or better off. So there are certain circumstances which may readjust the equation. But if everything is clear that you and your brother invested in this property, or let's just exclude the property completely. Speak about the father who has some money, and in his life he gave one of his children more than others, or he gave him and did not give the others. This is haram, because there is no reason. But if there is a reason, as I mentioned, the case is different. So we need to speak to the father and say, اتق الله عز وجل. اتق الله is not an insult, by the way. اتق الله means keep your duty to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because if you believe that you will be held accountable, you have to prepare answers for the very well-known questions. Why did you do that? Barakallahu fiqh Abu Muhammad. May Allah bless you and guide you and your entire family. Abu Abdullah from Nigeria.
Yes, assalamu alaikum, Sheikh.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
My question is as regards the fasting of the 10th of Muharram, Ashura.
What about it?
Okay. The hadith says the Prophet, I read the hadith, I said the Prophet said if he were to live law, if he were to witness the next year, he will fast on the 9th.
Now,
I want to find out, is it also sunnah to fast on the 10th and 11th?
Okay, I will answer this question. Ya Aba Abdullah, were you able to view Huda TV in Nigeria currently?
Yes, I'm viewing it now, but I had to change some, I had to make some adjustment to my G setting. C-band, and I did some work because I think a lot of Nigerians are having problems getting Huda right now.
Barakallah feek, because we definitely value our Nigerian viewers. I got some complaints that many of them were not able to view Huda TV. I don't know why. So alhamdulillah,
yeah, I had to make some adjustments before I could start viewing it again.
Okay. Barakallah feek. Maybe you need to find out what kind of adjustment and advise the viewers to do it. Barakallah feek, Abu Abdullah. Okay, let's continue what we said, and hopefully that will answer Abu Abdullah's question as well. So in the hadith of Abdullah ibn Abbas, and in other hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us why should we fast on the 10th of Muharram. Then after Ramadan was ordained, it has become mandub, recommended, sunnah, to fast on the 10th because of its virtues of forgiving the sins of the past year. Then, a year before the death of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his companions comprehended one thing. Normally, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to say, "Khaliful Yahud, Khaliful Mushrikeen, be different than the non-Muslims, be different than the Jews, do not look like them, even in the appearance, do not do their traditions. We are different, especially in the religious traditions." So they said, "Ya Rasulullah, the Jews do fast on the 10th, and we also fast on the 10th. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, yes, true. And that's why, لَإِنْ عِشْتُ مِنْ قَابِلْ, if I get to make it the next year, I will fast on the 9th along with the 10th. So this way will be different. So the scholars concluded the following, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam died before that. May Allah's peace and blessings be upon him. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enable us to see him, in our dreams, and to see him inshallah in paradise and gather around his basin, al-hawd, and drink from his hand sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cause us to die in the state of Islam and maintain our steadfastness on the straight path as long as we live, ya Rab. Anyway, the scholars concluded the following. Fasting on the 9th along with the 10th is a sunnah, because the Prophet ﷺ said it verbally, if I live, I will do that. If somebody did not get to fast on the 9th, he was traveling, he was sick, or, then it's recommended to fast a day after, because the effective cause of the ruling. Why? In order to be different. So fasting a day after will do it, but fasting a day before is greater than fasting a day after, because the Prophet ﷺ said, if I live, I will get to fast on the 9th along with the 10th. And fasting only on the 10th is permissible as well. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, now we're approaching the middle of Muharram, and this is a sacred month. It's also recommended to fast awfully during Muharram and do plenty of ta'at. It's a sacred month. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala during this month to bless the entire ummah. اللهم أمين غفر الله لي ولكم أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.